So I am Ashay Tamhane. I am working as a staff data scientist with Swiggy. However, today's talk is based on a slightly different domain. It's not about food, but about fashion. So the work done here was done for a leading fashion e-commerce portal. So just kind of want a shout out for my colleagues, Sagar Arora and Deepak Warrior. So just to give some background about this work. So as I said, this was done at India's leading e-commerce fashion portal, where there are a lot of apparel, footwear, and accessories being sold, which means stuff like, obviously, t-shirts, shirts, you know, jeans, dresses. Just some terminology, so going forward, I'll be referring to t-shirts, shirts, and those kind of categories as product categories. And when I say product, it's going to be like individual products within those categories, right? Just something to, you know. So what are the challenges, right? So as you can imagine, product catalog is large and dynamic. So at the time of this work, there were about 4 lakh products in men category and like 6 lakh products in women. And about 2,000 products gets added every day. So this is something unique about fashion that, you know, as opposed to other domains, the catalog is quite dynamic because fashion keeps changing, right? You can't keep showing the same set of products to people every day because stuff gets outdated very quickly. So that's an added challenge in this kind of domain, right? Now, given this large dynamic catalog, you know, you want users to find the products that they want very quickly, because if not, the products are going to churn very quickly, right? Or they'll drop out of their sessions, and obviously your conversion rate will go down. So to help users find the most relevant products quickly, you know, obviously personalization is critical. And especially in, you know, a field where you have so many products to see, it's very easy to get lost. And if people don't find something interesting, they are just not going to buy it. Now, let's say, you know, I wanted to build a very simple recommendation system, right? What would I do? So imagine a user who have started looking at like a woman kurta, then looked at a top, and then, you know, went to flat. So a very typical you know, approach to keep it simple would be to just look at the most similar product from every item that he has browsed and then just show it. Any ideas why it could go wrong if I just did that? Any thoughts? Yeah? Right, right. So, Andy, similar to what you just said, so one challenge is that, let's say this session was cohesive, right? Let's say someone just browsed all t-shirts. It would have been very simple because I can then show all similar t-shirts to him and that would have worked, right? But what do you do in this case, right? Where a person is switching the product category itself. So he started with like a woman kurta and then kind of switched tops and then actually went to flats, right? Now, do I give more weight to the recent ones? Do I give weight to everything? Like, what do I show to the person, right? So a lot of such challenges come up, and it quickly gets like a very slippery slope if you kind of start building rules on top of this. So we want like a more standard approach where we don't have to write hand code such kind of rules, but the model automatically tells us what the next kind of products, you know, we need to be shown to the user. So just to emphasize on the switching part, which I will kind of refer to as the context switch. So another session here, as you can see, right, it starts with her shirts, it has shorts, it has like a different type of a casual shirt, and then finally again shorts, right? So there's like a lot of switching happening. In fact, we see that, you know, 65% of line of million of, you know, session daily, they have more than one product category, right? So in the in terms of purchase data as well, like 41% of sessions, the actual purchased product is quite different from the first product that the person started with, right? Which means that people start with something and buy something else. So in the if you want an analogy with the offline shopping world, like think of going to a mall, and then you know, a lot of people do this window shopping, right? Where you kind of look at one product, even in within a store, you might start with something. Not necessarily you will buy the first item that you looked at, right? So this has a very strong kind of connect with even the online world where people do tend to do a lot of kind of window shopping. So let's come to the problem definition, right? So we know, we have defined that, you know, there's a lack of well-defined need in fashion e-commerce. So we've seen that the user behavior is impulsive. In the sense, I see something I like, I'll just go there, right? And hence, it's harder to predict, right? So what is the recommendation? I'm trying to predict what the person may like in the near future. That's what recommendation is. So given this kind of problem background, what we really want to do is, given a user session, P1 to PN minus 1, where P is an individual product, I essentially want to predict the next product that he might want to look at, right? So this is the problem definition. The challenges, as we saw, we already saw that the catalog is large and dynamic. New styles come big added, you know, daily, and they have no historical data. And on top of this, there are a lot of switches that keep happening. So how do you solve all of these problems together, right? So we use a combination of what we call as product groups. I'll talk about what that is in a minute. And then we use sequential modeling to kind of capture the context switches. So I think this will get more clear as we get into the talk. So let's start with what are product groups. At a high level, what we want is to handle the sparsity of the items. We say that we want to build something of a cluster kind of sort on top of products. So think of product groups as, in a very simple kind of language, like a group of similar products, and all of them should be, you know, replaceable with each other. As you can see as an example here, so there's a lot of similar looking shirts, not in terms of the color, but more in terms of the style. So you would look in terms of the color, in terms of the fit, also in terms of the brand proposition, and in terms of the MRP price of the product itself. So you won't find something which is like 8,000 or something in the same product group. So you want something as a cohesive product group which can capture well, you know, the similar products, you know, in one similar group. Now, though we won't go in all the details of this, and I'll put you know, the relevant links at the end of the talk, but I'll just give a kind of a gist of how we are making these sessions. Now, a very simple approach to do this, as you can imagine, would be if, imagine if every single item here had well-defined attributes, right? So I knew exactly what the fit is, what the color here is, how it, you know, looks on the arms and things like that. I could do something like a clustering, right? But the problem is that since this is manually cataloged items, you know, this is not that straightforward. So a lot of items have these tags misplaced. Some of them are wrong, and they don't really capture the style element to the full extent, right? So what we do is we augment that with user sessions. So we have a lot of historical user sessions, and imagine each session as a document. So I think people who have used Word2Vec by now, and most of you would have, you know, imagine each session as a document and every kind of word in the document being a product attribute, right? And then you have a bunch of products being done in that session. And then we use kind of skipgram word embeddings to kind of code each product attribute. Now that attribute kind of captures the session element as well. And hence, it is much richer than if you would just use individual catalog attributes, right? Again, like I'll put the link at the end of, so there are papers which kind of, you know, you could look at in the details of the implementation. Just to show another example of this, so if you look at, you know, the styles, though we are not actually using visual features explicitly, the user session actually augments those features because people tend to kind of, you know, look at the similar stuff. Though there are context switches, they also kind of have a cohesive element in the way they are doing it. So it turned out that when you use this user session kind of features extracted, it actually adds to the richness of the product groups. So we're making a slight change to our problem definition. So initially we looked at, given a user session of some products, we want to, you know, look at the next product. Now what I do is I just replace each product with its corresponding product group. And then the problem becomes, you know, given a user session with some product group seen, what is the next product group here? Now what this allows us me to deal with is sparsity, right? So let's say tomorrow there's a new kind of product which comes in. It's easy to map it to the relevant product group using the attributes because I know that mapping. And then I don't need to do anything else because I already have a model built at the product group level and I can use the same model, right? If I had to build this model at a product group level, first of all, as I said, sparsity at item level will be extremely kind of high. Even for the existing items, you won't find as many sessions for the exact same product, but you can actually do it for the product group. Let's talk about baselines, right? We don't want to jump directly into a very complex model because it should justify what we're doing. So as we saw initially, we looked at a similarity-based approach where I could just recommend some similar stuff. So what if I just did that? What if I replaced each product, which is product group, and then I just show like the most frequent product groups that a person has browsed? Like this would be like the first cut version of my model. This is like one majority voting-based approach. There could be another approach, right? I could imagine like a graph where each node is my product group, and given all this historical data, I just need to find the transitions between product groups. For example, if I know most people who see men t-shirts then go to men shorts, I can have like a probability associated with that. And I can use that very simply to recommend the next set of items. What's the problem here? The problem is that the entire sequence of the user journey will not be captured, right? So as you saw, people are looking at a lot of stuff, and that can actually have a final bearing into what he's seeing next. Because I might start a session with t-shirts, I can go to short, but that also increases my probability of switching back to a t-shirt later on, right? And you want to capture that. If I don't capture that, I might just look at shorts and recommend accordingly. So that's the major challenge that we'll be addressing in our approach. So a traditional kind of a machine learning approach would be to use something like an HMM. So for people who are kind of familiar with HMM, we have a bunch of hidden states like x1, x2, x3. And then from each hidden state, there are probabilities of observing the actual observation states, right? So in our state, the observations would be nothing but the sessions themselves. So we won't go into details of the HMM part. I'll just kind of give the intuition for it. So when we build this, one very interesting thing that we saw was we wanted to understand what the hidden states are. Like, can we actually analyze the observational probabilities and see what that hidden state means? So for example, what we saw was if a person is in a given hidden state, the emission probabilities were like shorts, sunglasses, hat, and others. Now what that could mean is that the user is probably looking for something for a beach state or a summer state, right? And if I can say that the user is in that state, I can predict according to that, right? So those were some of the things. A more kind of a modern approach would be to use like RNN, which are like probably most frequently used now. So it's similarly trying to capture the sequential modeling where given a bunch of items, we want to kind of predict the next item. So the products will be one-hot encoded here, and then each product group will be, a sequence of product group will be passed through the RNN, and we have like millions of samples to train with, so that's not an issue at all. Now we know that RNN kind of suffers from the vanishing gradient problem, so people who have worked with RNNs, and hence there are two approaches you can take, either use a LSTM or a GRU. In our approach, we have used a GRU. Now, coming to the gist of it, right, what are we trying to do? So we have a bunch of sequences of product groups. We feed it to the GRU, and essentially we are trying to predict the next set of product groups that the user might look at. Right? How would we evaluate this? I already know historical data. I cut it off at some point in the session, and I predict the next products in that session. Right? That is how we evaluate it. So coming to the evaluation bit of it, so people who have worked with recommendation would know like MRR and NDCG, these are like standard metrics. If you don't know what they are, don't bother, like just kind of look it up offline. Essentially, if these metrics are higher, your kind of model is better at kind of recommending, right? Now we compare with the baseline approaches, so the PG graph and the majority voting approach that we looked at, and we compare it with the GRE approach, both in terms of mean reciprocal rank and NDCG, and we see that the GRU one performs better, especially when the K increases. Now, K is nothing but how many items are you recommending? Are you recommending like 3 items, 4 items, 5 items? And we see, in fact, a trend there. So if you kind of look at the session length and kind of the MRR plotting with that, so we see that as the session is longer and longer, the model actually performs much better than the baselines, because there the context actually becomes more and more important, right? What I browsed in this session becomes more important. If for shorter sessions, it may not be that important, because if you have, let's say, 3 clicks, there's not much context switch that can happen in those 3 clicks, right? So that's why the session length becomes very important. Now, we see this behavior both for men and women, just to confirm the fact whether there's any gender kind of bias into it, and just make sure that the model works well, equally well for, you know, both the genders. Now, so this is how we kind of modeled it. Now, we also wanted to see, you know, how the model is kind of working behind the hood, right? Just to get an idea of what the model is doing. So what we tried doing is we artificially generated a few sessions from the model. Given the GRU, we kind of generated a few sessions, and we wanted to observe, are there any trends that the model is capturing, right? Because if you kind of sample from the model, and if you can see some trends, that means it's kind of have understood some aspect of your data. So in this particular session, you know, you could see that this session started off with, you know, kind of Western wear, a lot of Western wear sequentially, and then it switches to Indian wear. This is something that we also observe in our data, that you know, if someone doesn't kind of keeps looking at a lot of Western wear and they can't find something relevant, they actually switch to Indian wear, and many people might be more comfortable with Indian wear than Western wear, right? So they ultimately switch to that and they end up buying of Indian wear. Similarly, if you look at the men's collection, now this is quite interesting. So Roadster and Mass Travel are like value brands. Like if you look at the price below, it will be like 500, you know, 400 kind range. It kind of, in the session, there's a kind of an ambitious switch to Levi's, which is like 15,000. Now, if you look at the switch there, it's quite abrupt. Now, this is something that we have actually seen in a lot of sessions where people do, you know, browse, start with value brands. They want to kind of have that ambition of kind of switching to a more kind of a branded kind of a product. But then, you know, ultimately, you know, maybe they don't want to go with it, and they come back to, you know, the value brands. So you'll see a switch back to Roadster and Breakbounce after that, right? Where the value proposition is pretty similar to what we see. Now, what it means is that imagine a person who has seen a lot of products in his session, which are from value, and then you had a Levi's in it. Now, if you use something like a similarity-based approach, right, and let's say you, this was the last item that you looked at, you would recommend all Levi's similar items, right? It could be like very high brand, high premium items, which the user may not even be interested in. It was just an ambitious click. But if I used an approach which captures the entire context of it, it's highly likely that when I recommend stuff to him, I will recommend less of Levi's items and more of Roadster and Master and Harbor items. So this becomes like the context becomes like a very important thing here. So to conclude, as we saw, context changes are common in fashion e-commerce. And even if I remove the word fashion from there, in any domain that you look at, you can have a lot of analogies there. Like, so in any portal, any journeys, when the user is going through the products, it's very unlikely that the user has a very high intent of a specific product in mind. And he might actually, you know, do a lot of switches there. So in all those cases, they might look at, you know, you could look at similar approaches. And in such scenario, you know, sequential modeling with GRU performs better. That's what we observe. So that's my time. Thank you. Happy to take questions. Right. So here we were just looking at the items itself, the sessions. The intention for that was, many times what we see is historically you might be interested in a particular brand, but in a lot of times the session itself has a completely different trend, right? So you might have bought a lot of, you know, let's say Ferrari t-shirts before, but in this session you're looking at Levi's or something else, right? And that becomes like even more important than the historical data. So, yeah. Right. Sure.
So the model in this case is the same one, which is say for example, because it's all the same. But as a customer, I might have a different sequence compared to there is a similar problem with the guys. That's why.
Okay. Sure. So if there are different cohorts that we see that people behave itself differently, In that case, what you could do is kind of build different models for each segment of users. So let's say there's a segment who only looks at premium shirts. In that case, maybe the transition that we saw wouldn't happen, right? Then there would just be a transition from Levi's to something else, right? Maybe Levi's to Ferrari kind of thing. But there could be another segment which could be more like a value-based segment, and for them, like, there could be a different model. So it totally depends on the user kind of data that you have. If your users all behave like similarly, or if they have different cohorts, you could do that. So that's like the next step.
And one more question.
Sure.
Did you buy any chance to identify data on this?
No, not yet. In our work, we didn't. But that's something that could be kind of looked at.
Because we explored it.
Okay.
The advantage that it is a simpler
installation. Okay. Yeah.
But identification is faster, but what identification lacks is sequence.
Right.
It takes sequence, but it never outputs sequence. It tells you yes, these two, three.
Right. No, we didn't explore that. So in essence, we wanted to kind of just make sure that if you're taking a slightly complex approach than the baselines, like there should be a substantial shift, right? Because many times what happens is you do something complex and it can't even kind of beat the base, you know, basic heuristics. But you're right, like if there's something, you know, like item to work, we could try to compare how it compares with the MRR and NDCG. Yeah.
So I have one question here.
Yeah, okay. Hi.
So when you're comparing with the baseline, did you compare with another baseline which is sort of sequential but not using a model? For example,
if you use
some smoothing function, use similarity with respect to most recently interacted
got
item.
Got it. So
did that?
Yeah. So basically, when I talk about the product group graph, there are two versions of it that we tried. So one version of it is basically just look at the last item in the sequence and then look at the transitions from it. The other version that we tried was from each item in the sequence, you look at the transitions, and then you kind of add up the probabilities and normalize for it.
Yeah, and with so, decayed weights or something.
Yeah. Yes. So we tried that, but the GRU just like kind of does better than, you know, all those baselines. So I have not reported like all of those results here.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll kind of put up the link, as I said, in the paper, so you could kind of go in the more details of that as well.